Macmillan Audio presents The Outside Boy by Jeanine Cummins. Narrated for you by Alan Devally. Prologue. Ireland, 1959. I was dreaming of purple horses, myself on one and Martin on the other, and we was bareback and we was racing. These wasn't no strong, slow, piebald gypsy ponies like most of us travellers had in them days in Ireland for pulling our wagons home behind us wherever we went. No, in this dream, me and Martin raced thundering thoroughbreds at a proper race meeting, like at Punchestown in Dublin. And the crowd waved their colours and they roared for us. Never mind that we was travellers. They loved us anyway. Our purple stallions was 16 hands high at least, and we was so swift on them we nearly took flight. I had the coarse thickness of my horse's mane wrapped full around my fist, and I squeezed his big strong neck with my knees and kept my head down close beside his twitching ear. I whispered to him, "Go on, bucko." And he went and went, and we was leaving Martin and his horse in our dust, and then there was an almighty screeching howl that went up, and my purple horse vanished. And I was sitting up straight as a fence post in the dark, my blanket wrapped round my fist and my heart hammering. Dad was sitting up beside me too, and we blinked confusion at each other in the dark. We wasn't sure what had wakened us until we heard it again. A keen, raw and sharp. Dad's hands was like ghosts between us, and he gripping his own blanket close to his chest. "What?" he started, but before he could finish his sentence, the wail rose up again and engulfed the camp. I could feel every hair in my body, and the wraith-like cry seemed liquid, seeping up through the planks of the wagon and into our clammy nighttime skins. There was a terror in that sound that was all new to me. "Is it a banshee?" I asked Dad. He looked at me like I was gone soft in the head. "Come out of that nonsense, Christopher," he said to me. "You know there's no such thing as a bloody banshee." He shook his head at me crossly, and I felt stupid, and was glad for the feeling stupid. Of course there was no such thing as banshees. I was nearly 12 years of age, old enough to know better. But then there was a sudden bang bang on the door of the wagon, and I could feel my heartbeat clamber into my throat. My heels stuck into the floorboards, and I did a backwards crab gallop until I smacked into the wall. My chest was heaving as I stared past my dad at the wagon door. He was staring at it too, with eyes as wide open as mine. "Dad," I said. I wanted him to reassure me. Just a word, a squeeze, that it would be okay. "Wait there, Christopher," he said, and he started to move toward the door. And now the clatter at the door grew louder, and there was nowhere for us to go, only to cower inside and await the doom of the shrieking spectre who was rattling at our wagon door. I stopped breathing altogether, and the door creaked and swung on its hinge, gaping open into the frigid night. The cold air flew in at once and reached my bare ankles. I trembled over them, folded my arms around my scrawny knees, and shook like a wet hound. "Christopher!" the spectre shrieked, and it was my granny. She was calling my dad, who I was named after. Granny, heaped in blankets outside in the not-yet-pinkening light, her hair and eyes wild. Her mouth stood open and revealed all the gummy graves where her teeth used to be. She looked so unnatural that my terror was hardly relieved at all. Dad was only in his bare feet, and he made a frantic silhouette, leaping out of the wagon after his mother. I crawled to the door behind him and watched Granny deliver her unholy cries into the dark camp. I pulled my blue ankles up and tucked my blanket round them while I watched the horrible scene unfold. Granny, down on her knees, beside the deadened fire, rocking back and over so hard I feared she would topple into the ashes. The keen she let up was so thick and tender I could nearly see it coming out of her, her breath spiralling out violently in torrid colours, defeating the darkness and drenching the camp with grief. "Ma'am," my dad said quietly. He was in front of his mother now, and he had his hands on her shoulders. He shook her a small bit, but she took no notice of him. She tore at her white hair until she looked like a proper banshee herself. I started shaking again, and I wanted to believe it was from the cold, but my stomach was turning too. "Ma'am," Dad said again, louder this time, and shook her more roughly. For a moment I thought he would raise a hand to her, to snap her out of the state she was in. I swallowed all the billowing colours and held them fast inside me, but my knuckles stayed white, gripping the doorframe of the wagon while I watched. Uncle Finty was there now too, and they both looked small and helpless, standing beside the ruined fire watching their mother weep. My cousin Martin's head popped up in front of me then, and without a sound or a word, he swung the full weight of his body up on one arm and into the wagon beside me. He pulled open my blanket, and I was blasted with the cold again, until he burrowed and folded us in tight. In the closeness, he smelled like tree bark and moss. We watched our fathers. We tried not to watch Granny. "Go and check the wagon, Christopher," Finty said to Dad. My dad hesitated, put his hand on his brother's shoulder for a long moment, like he was gathering strength for what he knew he'd find. Then he nodded and turned towards Granny's wagon door. It was hanging open too. She howled again as he went. I shivered under our blanket to hear the sound of that wordless pain, unleashed and raw, galloping round the camp. Granny was like a toothless wolf. We watched without blinking while my dad disappeared into the wagon. Martin squirmed in even closer beside me, and I could feel his elbow stuck between two of my shivering ribs, like we was twins for a minute, instead of cousins. We was joined at the eyes and ears, joined at the dread. Everything was silent and stretched. Only the tidal rhythm of our shared breath pushed the seconds forward. I wished for my mother. Dad came out again, shaking his head. "He's gone," he said. His face was pale in the moonlight. "Gone." I knew what he meant. He meant my granda. My stomach clutched, but my mind resisted. I wasn't ready. My fingernails dug into the flesh of Martin's arm, but he didn't wince. He didn't even move. Only a shiver in his neck. A gulp. "Granda," I whispered, and I could feel a flood in my head, a distant, unleashed roar inside me. I dammed it up quick.
"Will we waken him, do you think?" Granny said.
Martin and I looked at each other in horror.
"Is she gone as well?"
he asked me.
"Gone in the head, like?"
Martin was always asking me things, even though he was a couple of months older than me. He was 12 already. I shook my head and tried to answer him. But just like Granda, my voice was away. We stayed there while the sky lightened lilac at the edges. Me and Martin joined at the hair, joined at the knuckles. We didn't move, didn't speak. I think he felt it too. Some unspoken sense that if we stayed very still, if we blurred into each other, it mightn't be real. We tried that elusive magic of stillness, hoping like we always did that we might capture it, and it might be the answer to everything. But in truth, we was children of motion, and we didn't know how to stand still then. We didn't even know that we could. Chapter 1. After a good bout of crying in the morning, Granny cleaned up Granda. She shaved him and dressed him, and we got on the road late. All day long she drove their pony and wagon herself, and Granda still inside, where she would usually be riding.
"Where will Granny stay?"
I asked, as we prepared to make camp that night, in a thick darkness. I had never known nobody who died before, only my own mam, and it didn't really count as knowing her, since we'd only shared 7 minutes of breath in this world. The rain was close.
"How do you mean?" Dad asked. "Where's she going to be sleeping?" I said.
"I imagine she'll sleep in her bed," Dad answered. I knew I shouldn't ask no more. I really knew, but it was confounding.
"Can we go in and see him?" I asked.
Cleaned and shaved and dressed, but still quite dead. "We'll go in when your granny invites us and not before," Dad answered.
It was 2 days' journey to where we would rest Grandad, to where we'd have to bury him, inside in the town where his own parents and grandparents was buried. I never fancied towns, the buttoned-up, closed-in feeling of them, the way the houses crowded themselves onto the narrow streets, pressed their shadows forcefully on the passers-by. I preferred the open tubber, the road, out the country, where all the rain-fed colours would be washed fresh and green. But sometimes it couldn't be helped. You had to go where you had to go. It was magnetic, that burial journey. The way we was marching the horses and ourselves there without thinking or talking or even eating. We filled our bellies with Granny's endless wash of tears. But I couldn't seem to find my grief as easily as the rest of them, even though I was Grandad's favourite. Or maybe because of that. I thought maybe grief was like an egg that had to be cracked open, and I just hadn't smashed mine yet. I was still holding it, cradling it, careful. One rare, dry, Irish summer's night, when I was 7 years of age, the buffers came for Grandad. We was all sleeping when them headlamps slid across my face in the blackness and then hung their bright round moons on the skin of the tent above me. My eyes was as wide as them luminous circles, but I didn't even twitch. Dad was still snoring beside me when I heard the car door open, and then 2 feet plant theirselves into the gravel of the road. The driver left the motor running. "Dad," I whispered, elbowing him awake. "Somebody's here." He sat up quick and silent, pulling his legs out from under the blanket to crouch beside me. He put a finger to his lips and motioned for me to scramble to the back corner of the tent, where I mightn't catch a rock in the head, if there was a shower of rocks coming. Them headlamps never brought good news. If it was the Gardaí, they'd only tell us to shift. They'd encourage us. They might even kick dirt across the fire and raise their night voices, their country accents. But if it was some rowdy buffers instead, stumbling homeward after a night on the drink, there might be thicker words, slurred and vicious. There might be a pelting of rocks to remind us not to stay too long in their town. There might be...
"Hurley's?"
The voice was close outside the tent flap. No slurring. No whiff of hostility. The voice was crouching like Dad, quiet. Dad lifted the flap of the tent, like the lids off the eyes of them headlamps, and now they shone into the tent directly, and there was no hiding in them beams. We was lit like daytime. Dad shielded his eyes with one arm, and I could see the buffer, bent at the waist. He was lean, young.
"Are ye Hurleys, camping here?"
the buffer asked.
"I need Stephen Hurley."
There was something frantic in the voice. A tremble.
"Who's asking?" Dad said.
"I'm Joe Burke. My dad is Eamon Burke from up the glen. We've an awful sick mare, falling."
He was just a kid, maybe 16, and his words came out in a cracked tumble. Dad stood out through the tent flap, and Joe Burke moved back to give him space. Dad was a head taller than him, at least, and twice the breadth.
"Please, we need help," the kid said. "Are you Stephen Hurley?"
But Dad was already moving past him, to stoop at Grandad's tent. 3 minutes later, I was sat in the back of Joe Burke's sedan, clutching Grandad's magic black bag across my knees. We bounced over ruts and flew over dips, and I was glad my stomach was empty, because it was my first time in a car, and it wasn't nothing like the easy pace of a horse and wagon.
"How long has the mare been labouring?"
Grandad asked Joe Burke.
"It's hard to know," he said. "She's been agitated since last night, so it might have started as early as that."
"Last night? As in, before bed this evening?"
Grandad interrupted him.
"Or before bed yesterday?"
Joe Burke glanced in the rearview mirror, almost afraid to answer.
"Yesterday," he said.
"Is she off her feed?"
"Yes, sir,"
Joe Burke answered.
"But only from this afternoon."
It was the first time I ever heard a buffer call my granddad sir. I watched moths dart and swoop through the ropey beams of light in front of us, like tracks we was hurtling down. We nearly squashed a fox on a bend in the road, but he dashed into the hedges just in time. How's my assistant? Grandad turned to look at me over his shoulder, and I nodded. And then we was pulling into the lane of a farm, and the tyres went spitting out gravel behind.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.